Today, the speed and scale of expansion is astonishing. And that presents a choice. Mega city turmoil or a consciously inviting urban environment. A smart city. San Diego is one of those cities poised to move in a smart direction. With an ocean that breathes life into its port and draws people to the city, it's a booming metropolis. It is attempting to manage the chaotic forces of growth, to evolve from industrial border town to a leading high-tech hub. And it's doing so through conscious urban planning. Today is the Little Italy Festival, an annual event that attracts more than 100,000 visitors for food, fun, and fiesta. It's part of a friendly, vibrant city. A city challenged by rapid expansion. A city striving for success in a crowded 21st century. And who better to find out how they're doing and becoming a smart city? The National Geographic's digital explorer, Andrew Evans.
San Diego is shocking to me. It's not at all what I expected because it's a huge city, but it doesn't feel like a big city. There really is a good vibe here, and you feel it from the minute you step off the plane.
Welcome to sunny Southern California. Bordered by the ocean, desert, mountains, and Mexico, it has miles of stunning beaches and a perfect natural harbor. The port has long been one of the city's major assets, and around four decades ago, city planners realized they needed to revitalize the commercial downtown to keep the city connected to its prized waterfront. Andrew heads to the harbor district to find out what's being done.
The Gaslamp Quarter is one of San Diego's most historic neighborhoods. But not so long ago, it was also one of its scariest. In the 1950s and 1960s, you really didn't want to come here. The streets were dark, bad things were happening, but the city decided that they wanted to preserve the beautiful Victorian buildings here and save some of the great flavor that makes San Diego so different from anywhere else. And they succeeded. In the 1980s, with new policies, they breathed new life into this area, and today they're some of the most vibrant and exciting streets in the city.
This reinvigoration is just one part of the concerted urban planning project by the community committed to creating a more livable downtown through new facilities, new jobs, and increased business. Andrew meets San Diegan designer Rob Quigley to discuss it further.
When I moved here, there weren't people downtown. It was like a ghost town. There had not been a new residence built there since World War II. Now there's tens of thousands of residences there. It's been an incredible transformation.
Most cities faced with rapid expansion respond with suburbanization. Not so for San Diego. An old, dead inner city space is being rejuvenated, and one of the keys to this revival is somewhat surprising.
In so many cities, bookshops are closing, and libraries lack the public support that they once had. But in San Diego, the opposite is happening. Not only did they build a new central library, but they put it downtown, an area that's been empty and forgotten for so long. So what does that say about the people of San Diego? Why would a library be so important for them?
Well, the city felt like it was missing a cultural heart. The central library is the only building that satisfies that role, not the city hall, not the police station. It's really this building. And there is, I think, a longing for that.
When lack of funding stalled the project, the community held gala events like this and raised a staggering $70 million. During the evening's festivities, Andrew catches up with the mayor, a man not surprised by such community spirit.
When I think about the tremendous growth and revitalization that we've had in the city, particularly over the last 25 years, where we're standing right here didn't exist. That makes the city very special. But what's also great is there's a sense of we're not done yet. We're constantly innovating. We're constantly changing. And I think that attitude is really what separates San Diego from other cities. San Diego's, we're still looking ahead.
A key indication of a smart city is an actively engaged community. And all the hard work is paying off. 3,000 people enter its doors every day, and 45,000 new library cards are now issued.
We live in a digital age, but you've made a building for books.
Well, this building has 400 computers. We hoped even to link our auditorium and meeting rooms with the University of California digitally, so there'll be a real-time ability to attend lectures in both locations. It's kind of a coming together of education and culture with high-tech overtones. But that's not to say that it doesn't need to function on the other level of community and people and camaraderie. The idea of community is not old-fashioned. It's timeless.
The San Diego Library is still filled with books, but it's so much more. It's a digital space that's completely wired, and it's a smart space where citizens can come together and learn and share and invent. This is the blueprint for the libraries of the future.
Unlike many cities under threat from rapid expansion, San Diego is actively nurturing its downtown. With the help of public funding, three spaces are bringing the community back to its urban center. Along the harbor is the ballpark of the San Diego Padres. Each game is capable of hosting almost 42,500 baseball fans. The convention center, venue for the world-famous Comic-Con, is a pop culture phenomenon and draws people from all over the country. And right on the water, in the heart of the city, the International Airport is connecting San Diego's downtown to the world, with non-stop flights to London and Tokyo. Facing the challenges of expansion, San Diego is making bold decisions. But it's all for naught if they don't make smart decisions about how people get around.
So I'm driving an electric car through San Diego. It's a nice, smooth ride, very clean. And in fact, in San Diego, they have more than 10,000 electric cars in use, which is impressive. We have a real problem with using too much energy. And San Diego has addressed it by finding new and creative ways and innovations to have more sustainable and clean energy.
With one of the highest adoption rates of electric vehicles in the world, and over 600 charging stations, in 2013 alone, San Diego saved 10,000 tons of greenhouse gas. Plugging an electric car into a 480-volt DC fast charger enables the driver to recharge the vehicle in 30 minutes or less. That's at least four times faster than the time it takes to charge using a regular US power outlet. Electric vehicles and the infrastructure to support them are just one part of the citywide drive to use energy more wisely. San Diego Gas and Electric is also helping lead this proactive charge, a cutting-edge, technologically advanced smart grid that enables its users to safely and reliably increase significantly the use of renewable energy. Jim Avery takes Andrew on a tour of the tech.
This meter is on every home here in San Diego, and it's taking electronic information and sending it to the utility company and to a website so the consumer can see it themselves. And with simple applications, they can understand how energy is being used and where it's being used and how much it costs.
This is a whole new way of managing a city's power. Digital technology enables two-way communication between the utility and users. Consumers can better manage their energy use and reduce their community's carbon footprint without compromising their lifestyle.
By the end of this year, about a third of our energy will be coming from renewable resources. Yet 10 years ago, it was less than 1%. In 10 years, we're going to have well over 100,000 plug-in cars on the streets. And from the standpoint of greenhouse gas emissions, San Diego will be one of the cleanest utilities in the world in the next 5 to 10 years.
Tying together San Diego's efforts to stay green and clean and continue its rapid growth is the port. It operates an onshore power system connecting to the city's smart grid. While berthed, each vessel is plugged in eliminating the need to run diesel engines, drastically reducing fuel emissions and effluent. And the benefits are clear to see. It's a recreational destination and a busy working harbor.
The port is critical to San Diego's success. It really is what put San Diego on the map. It's what connected it to the rest of the world. And having the downtown right next to the port, that's very unique in a modern city. But I think more important is if you look at the history of the world, port cities all over the world have always been a step ahead of other people because they allow for that interchange of people and culture and ideas. And I think the port in San Diego is a symbol of that.
San Diego, where the desert meets the Pacific Ocean, is one of the fastest growing cities in the US, and the allure isn't a modern phenomenon. Long before Europeans trekked across the continent, San Diego was settled by sailors from Spain. And successive waves of immigrants continue that inexorable expansion. Today, technology plays a crucial role in urban transformation, and a critical success factor is the development of tech-savvy talent. With one of the highest concentrations of tech companies in the US, it's proving a magnet for new talent. Andrew wants to find out how and why. A good place to find specific answers is in one of the city's many academic institutions.
Looking ahead, smart cities will have to find new sources for fuel, food, and medicine. And in San Diego, they're finding those solutions in their own backyard with an organism that's so common and you can find anywhere, algae.
At the University of California, San Diego, Dr. Stephen Mayfield is spearheading biotech research that could change the world.
The simplest way to think about algae is that it is a photosynthetic organism, so just like a plant, except it lives in water.
This simple aquatic plant has limitless potential. From brand new cancer treatments to the production of food protein.
Whoa, this is like a comic book lab.
But the application getting the most traction is an eco-friendly biofuel.
The first question that a lot of people say is, you know, why are we going to use algae for biofuels? And the simplest answer for that is because we already do right now. So 100% of the petroleum that we drill and pull out of the ground is algae oil. It's not melted dinosaurs like people think. It's just ancient algae that has been kept underground for a couple hundred million years, and that became crude oil. So in many ways, it's not a new invention, what we're trying to do. The difference is that rather than having oil that's been sequestered underground, we're growing it in ponds in real time. We have identified species of algae that grow very rapidly. They produce the right oil, the right lipid content. We have a process that we can take that to scale. We harvest it, we extract the oil out of it, and we've sent that oil to refineries, and they have converted that oil into gasoline and diesel.
You're telling me I can drive my car with pond scum?
You can drive your car with pond scum. Once we make it into gasoline, it is identical. You cannot tell the difference when you go to a gas station and pump algae gasoline into your car versus crude oil. The reason it's less polluting is because the carbon that's in that was captured from the atmosphere the week before by photosynthesis. So it's low carbon fuel. Our corn crop this year is 100 million acres. If we took 40 million acres of that corn crop and turned that into algae at the same scale, we would produce 100% of our transportation fuels.
That's amazing. Now, why did this get developed in San Diego?
This got developed in San Diego for really interesting reasons. Reason number one was that Scripps Institution of Oceanography was built here 100 years ago. And you cannot study the oceans and not study algae. They are just the fundamental of the ocean ecosystem, right? So there was already a group of scientists here working on it. But then San Diego is a biotech hub. That means that we have the sort of the venture guys here, the financial resources to invest in it. You've got this huge biomedical community. So one of the things that we've done in algae biotech is we borrowed from those guys. So we borrowed all of their high throughput equipment. We simply borrowed it, bent it a little bit, and now we do algae biotech in this.
A unique confluence of research and academic institutions, forward-thinking investment, and world-class talent is combining to make San Diego a world-leading tech hub. Instrumental to the genesis of this in 1960 was City Mayor Charles Dale. As a polio survivor, he made it a personal quest to build the Salk Institute of Biological Science in San Diego. And in a building designed by renowned architect Louis Kahn, Jonas Salk, developer of the polio vaccine, established a world-class research institute to explore questions about the basic principles of life, a heritage that continues today.
Just like Silicon Valley gave us the personal computer, San Diego's biotech industry has done something completely revolutionary.
Illumina, a life sciences and diagnostic tool manufacturer, has become one of the leaders in making sophisticated machines that sequence DNA.
This is a HiSeq 2000.
They've taken a highly complex scientific process, sequencing the human genome, and they've made it faster, more affordable, and more accessible. Oh, you just scan it?
Yeah.
Like at a grocery store.
At the forefront of this biotech breakthrough is Dr. Rick Klausner.
In the 1990s, it cost you $3 billion to map the human genome and took you 15 years?
Mm-hmm.
How long does it take now and how much does it cost?
Now it costs less than $1,000 and takes a little over 24 hours.
This dramatic development could be one of the most significant achievements in modern personalized medicine.
The human genome is the instruction manual that defines the biology of human beings. It is the knowledge door that allows us to bring science to human health.
So what are the medical applications of having the human genome?
The medical applications are going to touch every aspect of health and disease. We read the genome and you get information about the risks and the probabilities that individuals will have of getting certain diseases. That's one thing. Even more dramatic is the idea of people in their home will be able to actually sample their saliva and read, literally, do we have cancer? What type of cancer do we have? And that's where we're gonna have the biggest impact on medicine.
So why San Diego?
There's a small number of places around the world that have been at the center of innovation. They all have a set of three characteristics. One, they have truly world-class academic research institutions. Two, they have world-class investors that are interested in entrepreneurship. And then the third thing, it actually has to be an attractive place to live. That's the secret sauce. It's a very informal place of openness, of feeling like it's a place that young scientists want to come and begin their careers. And San Diego is an incredibly attractive place to be for that.
Attracting talent is only half the equation. Managing and maintaining that growth for the future is crucial. San Diego is also nurturing the next generation.
So I wanted to show you some of the creations that these kids have made. Okay. And they're pretty ridiculously awesome.
Qualcomm, the world leader in next-generation mobile and wireless technologies, has decided to nurture the future. In this lab, children from all over San Diego come to exercise their creativity. Utilizing all kinds of electronics, servos, resistors, circuit boards, and solar panels, it's a 21st century classroom for today's tech-savvy kids.
This is what they've created in less than an hour. And they didn't know any circuitry or programming before.
Giving Andrew the lowdown on what this initiative is trying to achieve is program head Navreena Singh.
We are big believers in the fact that leaders don't create a set of new followers, they actually create more leaders. Mm-hmm. What we are providing here is a real vision, a real piece of future for our young kids who get to play around with technology, who get to interact with real life role models who are engineers and scientists and technologists.
I'm just saying, cool, right?
Sheer brilliance, I love it.
the reason we selected the 6 to 8 graders is this is a very impressionable age. This is a time that they're really forming their opinions about what they want to do in their lives. So what we are trying to do is really encourage the future generation of technologists and innovators. It's all about real world applicability, and we are trying to just keep it very real here.
What these kids are learning is how to be innovative. The things that they're doing are no different than all of the other amazing innovations I've witnessed in San Diego. They may be less practical, but I watch those kids, and I know that in 10 or 15 or 20 years, they're going to be running our lives.
It's over!
This spirit of innovation permeates the city. None more so than with a locally produced aviation groundbreaker that is pushing the limits of unmanned aircraft.
Now, when we hear unmanned aircraft, most of us think of the military. But in San Diego, that technology has some very smart applications that reach far beyond the base.
The Global Hawk is an autonomous, high-altitude aircraft. And Andrew meets one of the original developers, George Guerra.
Well, it was originally developed back in the mid-90s as a project for DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. It was envisioned as something that could stay up there for long periods of time at high altitudes and cover vast geographic areas.
Flying at up to 65,000 feet, the Global Hawk relays real-time images back to base from a unique perspective. The extraordinary capabilities of military reconnaissance drones led to their use in controversial anti-terrorist missions. But now, the unarmed Global Hawk is casting its eye over the world for science.
How did the technology of the unmanned aerial system evolve from military use to its current applications?
It was in 2007 when there were fires burning here in Southern California. There was a need to understand what was happening with those fires, and Global Hawk flying as long as it can and being at that altitude, you can take a lot of pictures and use that to guide relief teams to get to those areas. With a system like this, you're giving them real-time data. And it was great to hear a firefighter say, "You don't know how valuable your data was to me and how I was able to help save lives and property."
In addition to disaster relief, the Global Hawk is helping NASA track climate change by imaging inaccessible Arctic regions and providing crucial information on hurricane development.
Literally, it's a click of a mouse that will actually can launch the system.
To find out if this system can make high-altitude aerial work open to civilian applications, Andrew's going to fly one, and at a significant distance, on the other side of the country.
And so you can hit the launch command.
Are we ready to launch? All right.
We're set.
Launching.
And you'll see up here, the aircraft is now lifting
We're
off.
We're taking off. Oh, no. Okay. I couldn't believe that we actually have this technology, that we can send aircraft up who can give us real-time information.
So you're presently flying at 30 knots airspeed and accelerating.
I got so excited just sitting there, and suddenly I wanted to fly this thing to all of these places in the world because I wanted to see what was happening there right then.
Why did such a unique technology start here in San Diego?
I think part of it stems from the aviation history that's here in San Diego, from the early days of the Spirit of St. Louis for Charles Lindbergh, and really good schools. We never seem to have a shortage of people that are interested in working in this type of area. We're proud of the fact that, you know, we developed it here in San Diego, and we're continuing to grow that technology from the first days of when we started Global Talk to what it's evolved today.
People here are working very hard, and some of the things they're doing are extremely serious. But it doesn't feel that way when you talk to them. It's almost as if they're playing. You know, they're playing with technology, and the things that they're finding have very serious implications for the city, but for the whole world.
A fast-growing city is often a city of diversity. But how is San Diego managing the potentially damaging forces of assimilation? To explore this crucial aspect of a modern, tolerant metropolis, Andrew's going back to the beginning.
Before the United States was a country, San Diego was a city. And it started here at this old mission, founded in 1769 by Franciscan monks who had sailed up from Mexico. They named the spot San Diego de Alcala after the Spanish saint. And today in the city, you can still feel that old Spanish flavor.
A Spanish heritage seen in many of the buildings of Balboa Park. Designed by architect Bertram Goodhue for the 1915 International Exposition to celebrate the completion of the Panama Canal, the intent was to capture the romantic glamour of Seville and Toledo in Spain. In addition to the colonial revival buildings, the 1,200-acre park was extensively landscaped for the expo, leaving a lasting legacy in the city. But maintaining older monuments won't by itself solve modern diversity problems. To discover how San Diego does it now, Andrew heads back downtown to Barrio Logan. At the foot of the Coronado Bridge is the colorful Chicano Park, a public space created by residents.
As San Diego grew, this neighborhood was slated to be destroyed. The vision of urban developers was basically to build a bridge here and turn this into a gray, dead space. But the original inhabitants of this neighborhood, the Mexican Americans, came together and they said no.
Forming a human chain around the bulldozers, construction work had to stop.
They wanted to keep their mark on this place, so they added these murals of their heroes. What's most remarkable is that today, the most prominent bridge in San Diego represents a bridge to the city's most prominent culture.
Across the US, immigrant populations are being dissolved into the American cultural melting pot. But here in San Diego, communities proud of their heritage are maintaining their diversity.
There's urban renewal, and because of our concerns with energy and living space, it just makes sense for people to move back into the city centers. But it doesn't happen automatically. You have to make very specific decisions. And what I admire in San Diego is that they really want to keep the original flavor of the neighborhoods. So for Barrio Logan, they really want to treasure the old Mexican past and what that means.
Barrio Logan is one of the oldest and most culturally rich urban neighborhoods in San Diego. It seems to be working. San Diego is one of the most ethnically diverse cities in the US, with over 100 different languages spoken.
I feel like San Diego reflects a tradition that you see in port cities all over the world, which is that people from so many different countries and cultures collide. You have the Mexicans, the Vietnamese and Filipinos and Chinese all coming together. It's this beautiful eruption of new things. And that really is a force for innovation.
An upside to the cultural mosaic where communities are encouraged to preserve their heritage is the food.
What a glorious day. Welcome, Andrew.
Thank you. This is beautiful.
Today, Andrew is tagging along with local luminary, Chef Su Mei Yu.
See, in the middle of nowhere, we're surrounded by mountains and arid area and oak trees.
Su Mei is shopping for produce for her restaurant in one of the 6,000 small farms that surround the city.
This place is called El Campito, which is a little camp owned by a friend of mine named Philippe Arisa. Hola, Philippe.
Hola.
How are you, Philippe? This is my friend Andrew. This is Philippe Arisa.
Hi, Andrew.
Hello. Nice to meet you. Very nice to meet you. So how do you support a 10-acre farm nowadays?
Well, what we do is we go directly to chefs. Chefs nowadays are much more interested in getting high-quality produce.
So this is kale.
Toscano kale. It's an heirloom variety from Italy. We go back to old heirloom varieties where you have all that flavor, you have all that nutritional value, everything is there, and nothing's been genetically modified to last longer just because, you know, it will ship better. It's not about that.
Farms like these, local, ethical, and sustainable, have a symbiotic relationship with the city. And connecting big city demand with small farm supply are forward-thinking chefs like Su Mei.
Well, Su Mei, how are farms like this changing the way that you cook?
As a cook, you start to create as soon as you see a product. And I thought, I know what I could do with this. So in some manner, he's helping me to generate new recipes. I would bring back to him from Thailand some seeds and say, grow these. And then he helps me by growing exotic, beautiful things that I could go back and spark comes into my mind of what to do with them.
San Diego is breaking the trend. Instead of large corporate farms, they have small family farms right next to the city. Smart cities, the cities of the future, will need smart chefs and smart farmers coming together in a food revolution.
How do you feel that all the different immigrants who come to San Diego help change the local taste?
A tremendous amount of surprises and contrasts. And it has excited the San Diegans who lived here for centuries to know that the hamburger would never taste the same again because of the food and influence from Southeast Asia, from Africa, from the Filipinos, from the Guamanians, regardless of where you came from, what nationality, because all of us would like to maintain healthy eating. People would come in and eat this dish called brain food because it is really good for your brain. Not bad, right?
That's great.
You didn't make any mess.
Yeah, not at all. That is remarkable.
I think you like it. Thank you.
Sume's cooking reflects very ancient cultures. She's Chinese. She brings millennia of recipes and traditions to the U.S. And then she sources it all from a Mexican organic farmer. Cultures collide, and suddenly they're thrown together, and they're trading things, even if it's just a recipe or an idea or a way of doing things. So that's why it's so San Diego, and it's so much fun.
Another local speciality that combines such conscious consumption with a cutting-edge biotech industry is beer.
There's a population here that values quality brew, and there are scientists dedicated to improving on the world's oldest drink. It's that spirit of appreciation in the bar and the laboratory that makes San Diego Grand Central for craft beer.
One of those dedicated San Diegans at the forefront of the craft brewing industry is Neva Parker. As head of laboratory operations, she specializes in developing yeast, a key biological ingredient in the brewing process.
So how many different kinds of yeast are there?
There are countless strains all over the world, but here we have a collection of over 500.
And these are yeasts that are found in nature?
They are found in nature. We collect these yeast strains from all over the place. Each one does something a little bit different, and that's what craft brewers are really looking for.
This is fruity.
Kind of separating their beers and using the strains to make really unique flavors. Besides just their base recipe, you know, your malt, water, and hops, yeast adds another complexity to those beers.
So it's a science that becomes an art.
Exactly.
In addition to producing yeast, Neva and her team can analyze the final product.
So what does this machine actually do?
So what this guy is going to do is it's going to measure all of the flavor compounds. It'll tell us how much of that flavor compound is in the beer.
So it's like a personal horoscope for a beer.
Exactly. It is a horoscope. So just push the start button there.
All right, so this is it.
There's a lot of compounds that you see here.
I don't know any of these flavors.
Starting from the top, acetaldehyde is one that we consider green apple, sometimes sherry in high quantities. Something like isoamyl acetate comes across really banana. Like a wheat beer, typically you'll see high amounts of isoamyl acetate because that's pretty characteristic.
Every flavor is really just a chemical compound.
Exactly, it is a chemical compound. And those are all produced from the yeast fermentation.
And what makes this state-of-the-art biotech so much fun is the end result.
So this is the final product.
That's right.
There are nearly 100 craft breweries in San Diego, and that makes perfect sense to me that they would be the ones to develop a new technology for a space-age yeast that's able to improve the taste of craft beer.
Oh, that's nice, really bright, citrusy.
Yep.
Because they've applied the same innovative spirit that they have for technology to beer. That's San Diego.
In the near future, most of the world's population will live in cities. The luckiest people will live in small, planned, and smart cities like San Diego. But all the urban planning in the world would come to nothing if the city had blown its greatest asset, the ocean. Safeguarding the health of the ocean life and its resources is key. Without it, even the smartest city will falter. It is a tough task. It's made doubly difficult for San Diego due to an explosion in its population. But with big picture planning and preservation projects, they are making a difference. At SeaWorld San Diego, the city's major theme park, they're protecting ocean life with research that has led to medical advances in the care of marine animals.
Dr. Schmidt.
Hi.
Hi. Andrew, how are you?
Andrew's guide for a look behind the scenes is Dr. Todd Schmidt.
Well, I did not expect to be wearing a coat in San Diego.
I know. It's unexpected. It's cold. It's cold. All right.
First stop, a penguin encounter.
I love penguins, and I've been very fortunate in my travels to see every species of penguin in the wild. To come to San Diego, the place with the best climate in America, and to find 400 penguins, all happy running around a room, was fantastic. I loved it.
And if the breeding program is anything to go by, the penguins love being here.
Do you think these penguins know they're actually in California?
They probably don't, because they're on the austral light cycle. So we're replicating Antarctica. They haven't had any light cycle change, so it helps them with their hormonal patterns and then with their breeding cycle will encourage that success with breeding.
SeaWorld says that since 1980, more penguins have hatched here than any other exhibit in the world. But that's not the team's most striking success. They're rescuing ill, orphaned, and injured animals and helping them with groundbreaking regenerative medicine.
So how do you think this stem cell research you're doing will help out in the future?
I'd rather use the penguin's own cells to treat them than use drugs or pharmaceuticals. So if we can actually afford a better quality of life by using a stem cell to treat a degenerative condition, then I think that penguin will be better off as it lives longer. This is the first, no one's done this before in an exotic species, so we're gonna be kind of the first ones to test this out.
Little does he know, but this Gen 2 penguin will be the first ever penguin recipient of this procedure.
Our keepers have watched this animal's behavior, so we know that it does have a visible lameness with its left leg. We can also see on this radiograph, there is extra bone proliferation on the outside of this knee joint. And this is the knee joint here that we're gonna be treating today.
These are penguins that have lived well beyond their natural life expectancy. And not only have they lived long, but they're able to give them quality of life. That's something that is really science fiction for humans.
As they come to consciousness, they often start flapping their wings, so that's what you may see.
We can't grow new cartilage in a human knee, but we can do that with a penguin now.
All right, there you go. He's free. Oh, a little woozy still. I can't believe how quick it is. You know, we just brought her in, we did it, and she's up and running again. That's outstanding.
To see such cutting-edge science applied to animals is so hopeful for me because it gives me a vision of what the future will be like. Smart cities won't just be about the people who live there, but smart cities will also take care of wildlife. They'll be cities of conservation.
Another example of such environmental policies lies offshore.
Hello.
Welcome, Andrew.
Thank you. To attempt to catch a glimpse of
a once rare marine mammal, Andrew's hitched a ride on a famous vessel. His guide for the day, Captain Troy Sears.
I'm so excited. I've never been sailing before.
It's a fantastic way to be introduced to the sport and the passion that I've had my whole life for sailing.
So tell me a bit about the history of this ship.
Well, this is the only replica of the original schooner that the America's Cup is named after. So the original boat was built in 1851 to showcase American naval architecture at the first World's Fair. And this boat was built in 1995.
They're huge. These are huge sails.
Yeah, we're carrying about 6,000 square feet of sail area.
That's bigger than my apartment. The geography of the bay is just incredible. It's like the most natural harbor you could ever see.
The port is important for commercial cargo, but it's also the largest naval base on the U.S. West Coast.
We very much have a working waterfront here, and it's very important to our economy, actually. Not just the U.S. Navy, but all the jobs that support the U.S. Navy. There's not many locations left in the United States where ships are actually being constructed, and San Diego is one of those locations.
But with smart decisions like the onshore power system and strict regulation, this hub of industrial marine activity is also home to the California blue whale. Once on the edge of extinction, these beautiful mammals are making a comeback. And in addition to attracting marine life, San Diego is a magnet for the world's best competitive sailors. Skipper for hire, Australian Jimmy Spithill, is a two-time winner of the prestigious America's Cup.
What was it about San Diego that made you love it so much?
I've lived in a lot of big, fantastic cities, but I've always found it hard to get a vibrant city where you can also feel quite relaxed. And that's what I find with San Diego. Out of all the cities in America, it's got that vibrant feel and a lot of pace and energy, yet it's still, it's not overwhelming. The lifestyle is very relaxed.
To understand the key to that relaxed lifestyle, Andrew heads for the city's communal heart, the beach. And with 70 miles of breaks, this is a city that, among many other sports, loves to surf. For some, it's also an opportunity to give back to the community. Surfing Hall of Famer and San Diego native Rob Machado is inviting Andrew to join a group of kids with disabilities at a surf clinic.
Then it's my turn. So I jump on the board and I'm waiting and I'm waiting. And Rob says, paddle now, paddle fast. And then I was just like in a washing machine, just tumbling. And I knew I wasn't surfing. I was just kissing the sand.
You know, it's actually really moving to watch these kids surf because they don't give up. They just go at it again and again and again. And they're not thinking I'm limited or I can't do this. They're just like, I'm gonna do it till I do it.
It's an enriching experience for everyone, students and teacher.
That was so inspiring to be down on the beach today and to be able to help out. Beautiful day. I saw a kid stand up on a surfboard with one leg, and I honestly don't think I could do that if I tried. And he might have been maybe 10 years old, but I think my jaw was in the water. I was like, oh my gosh, so cool, so inspiring.
I've seen all age groups, I've seen kids, I've seen grandparents. It seems that everybody surfs here.
Surfing to me in San Diego is kind of synonymous, right? There's just a lot of good vibes around the beach. You take advantage of the outdoors when you live in San Diego. And it's very prevalent when you drive around on any given day, people running, biking, surfing, you know, skateboarding, it's all happening. To be able to start your day like that, or to have that as part of your life, like that is such a healthy balance.
Not to get too metaphysical about it, but the fact that everyone here goes to the beach so often, they all go into the water, and it's this commonality, this baptism by water. So many of the people I've spoken with, be they a microbiologist or a chef, a lawyer, a school teacher, they all have fun. And the city that has fun together, no matter what creed or color or background, that's wonderful.
And that is San Diego, the perfect storm. A city educating the talented innovators of the future. A hub for cutting-edge inventors. A city where talent, innovation, and technology live together with outdoor sports and relaxed lifestyle. A city where its inhabitants work together to create a new breed of city, the 21st century city.
I feel like San Diego redefines what smart means. In San Diego, a smart city is a city that works for everybody. It's a city that isn't daunted